Good morning. We're learning Tractate Shabbos, page 129, Kuf Chavtes Amud Aleph. Start from Ravashi. Utsrichoani, we start from Tsrichoani, top of the page, Ben Lom, Utsrichoani, and Mechalmes Shabbos. Says, we said, we ended off yesterday that if the womb is not open, so whether she says I need or I don't, whether she said or she didn't say, we do not desecrate the Shabbos. So only when the womb is open, then we mechalel the Shabbos. Desecrate the Shabbos. Ravashi Masneochi, Ravashi teaches. Ma'azutra Masneochi, Ma'azutra. However, it teaches Shmuel's ruling according to this following version. Amar Budama Shmuel Chayo. Woman who has just given birth, called Manshakya Pasuach, as long as the womb is still open. Also, dealing about a woman that already given birth. If she's before giving birth, doesn't make a difference whom the womb is open or the womb is not open. She's a pregnant woman. She tells you, I need to go to the hospital. You gotta take her. You gotta chal Shabbos for her. Whatever she right. says you, but if she already gave birth, you're continuing to be mechal Shabbos until what point? Until the womb is closed. So Amar Buda Mashmur, Kol Mashakir Pasuach, woman who's just given birth, as long as the womb is still open. Whether she asks or whether she doesn't ask, mechal Lusha Shabbos, you desecrate the Shabbos. Nistam Akever on Watzrichani and mechal Lusha Shabbos. Once that the womb is closed already, then we do not desecrate the Shabbos. On her account. Lo motzicha ani ein mechalel Shabbos. Oh, so if she says, even though the womb was closed, if she says, I need something, you desecrate the Shabbos for her because she just given birth. But if she doesn't say, you don't desecrate the Shabbos. A pregnant woman about to give birth, whether she says something or not, you desecrate the Shabbos for her. A woman that already given birth, at least this is the version of Mazuto.
Yeah.
If she asks, you mechalel Shabbos for her. If she doesn't ask, you do not desecrate the Shabbos. Amar Rabbi Menashe Amitay Masne Lekula Mazutra teaches a lenient version of Shmuel's ruling. Ravashi Masne Lechumra, whereas Ravashi teaches stringent version of that ruling. Ilchas Hakeman, in accordance with whom is the halacha? Amar Le Halacha Kemazutra. Why? Sofek Nefoshes Leokel, uncertainty involving life and death. We are bidden to rule leniently. Bidden to rule leniently. Right. Therefore, must follow Mazuto's more lenient position. See, that's why they have a doubt. They close the shul because they have suffic nefoshes.
Yeah. You can see it can still close away. You
know. Huh?
You have an argument to close it now.
But also, some shoes are targets for terrorism. Maybe you should also close them because they're targets.
I mean, there's no end to it. I mean, that's the problem.
Memos psichas hakever. So, from when is the womb of a woman giving birth regarded as open? When is it? From what point it's regarded as open? Amar Abaye mishar shetesh v'al hamashbe. From the moment she sits on the birthing stool. Rabuna Breda Rishoma Mishosh Adam Shelvio. Rabbi Rabuna says, no, it's from the time that the blood is dripping down as a result of labor. And the other opinion that says, from the moment that the labor is so intense that her friends must support her by her arms because she cannot walk on her own. Until when is the womb considered open? 3 days after birth.
Hospitals are not that way.
Right. Rav Amar Mishmed Rav Yehuda Shivo. Rav said 7 days in the name of Rav Yehuda. Bamula and others say 30 days. It's still open. Doesn't mean that they have to stay in the hospital, but she goes home. But it doesn't mean that her womb is still closed. It's closing as
it's probably better.
Slowly, it's closing down, but it doesn't happen immediately.
It's probably better most of them that they send them out right away. The way it is now with about insurance.
It all depends where you're staying, you know.
You know, did you ever see a birthing chair?
Yeah.
You saw it?
Of course.
I mean, no, but in a hospital, they have them laying down. And the real way that your birth is, in, you know, pushing down. That's where they have the birthing chair.
Oh, they have
chair.
A chair that...
Right, it has a hole in it. And the, no, the midwife stays underneath to catch the baby.
Right. No, but it doesn't mean that if she stays in the hospital, she always stays on the birthing chair. She gives birth, and then she lays
okay,
on a bed.
She can lay down.
She lays down,
right,
and
that's
then.
Okay.
But he tells you that the womb is still open,
yeah,
just because she's laying down and she's done.
They gotta get rid of the afterbirth, and then it heals up.
Right, the placenta comes out,
right,
and even then it takes time for
right.
some women tear.
Right,
right,
right. That's the bad news with the tear.
Women who has just given birth with corresponding differences in the circumstances under which we may desecrate the Shabbos on our account. Gimel, Zayin, Velamet. Gimel is three days. Zayin is 7 days. And the Lamet is 30 days. So halachically, I think if within 3 days, if she gave birth, let's say on a day before Yom Kippur, she doesn't have to fast on Yom Kippur. It's within the three days.
No, she shouldn't. Not only does she shouldn't fast.
Shouldn't, yeah.
It's not only she doesn't have an option.
Yima ben amo tzichani ben amo loy tzichani until the end of 3 days, whether she says, I need it, or whether she says, I do not need it, we desecrate the Shabbos on our account. So that's on the first 3 days. Now, Zayin Omotzichani, 7 days, if she says, I need something, we desecrate the Shabbos.
Right,
Omotzichani.
Right, that's
what
it says.
If she says, I do not need, Ein mechalan les Shabbos. We do not desecrate the Shabbos on our account. Lamed. 30 days. Afilu amo tzichani. Even if she says I need it. Ein mechalan les Shabbos. We do not desecrate the Shabbos on our account. Aval oisin aledei aramai. But we do it for her on the Shabbos through a Gentile. Edavu labreid ravilai. And this last ruling is in accordance with the ruling of Rav Ula, the son of Rav Ilai, Dama, Kotzer, Chol, Nasi, and Daramai, B'Shabbos. So that all things necessary to provide for the needs of a sick person may be done through a Gentile on Shabbos. Rav Amnuna, Dama, Rav Amnuna, Dovo, Sheesh, B'Sakon, Oim, Enochi, B'Isa. In the case of something needed by a sick person, but which does not entail a threat to life, if withheld from him, one may say to a Gentile,
goy.
I know, but one may say to a Gentile that he should do it for him on the Shabbos. Sometimes I just pause to breathe.
Oh, sorry.
It's okay.
I didn't know.
It's
I didn't
okay.
know why you were.
Said the name of Shmuel, for a woman who has given birth, there is a time limit of 30 days. In regard to what law was this ruling said, Na'adon say in regard to immersion, that is, a woman should not immerse herself in a mikvah for 30 days after childbirth, because she is then particularly sensitive to the cold.
Well, now we got hot mikvahs, so that doesn't work.
Amar Rav Olamor and Lashen Ba'aleimo, we said this law only in cases where her husband is not with her at home. Aval Ba'aleimo Ba'ale Mecham. If her husband is with her at home, in which case she will have relations with him after immersion, then she may immerse without concern for ill effects of the cold because her husband warms her. during relations, one body is warmed by the other. There was an incident involving the daughter of Rav Chisda. We immersed ourselves within 30 days of childbirth when her husband was not present, and she became chilled. Whereupon they transported her in her sick bed in pursuit of her husband Rava all the way to Pumbedisa so that she could be warmed by him. Daughter of Chisda was Rava's wife.
Yeah.
And it says in the Gemara, in Tosfos in Nida, Dibro Metchel Afilu, who recalled that Rava's wife was indeed healed from the chill by the warmth of her husband. We may make a large fire on the Shabbos to warm a woman who has given birth. So we know they understood from this ruling, for a woman who has given birth, yes, we may kindle a fire on the Shabbos as a matter of course. But for a sick person, no, we may not kindle it as a matter of course. They also understood from this ruling that during the winter, yes, we may kindle a fire for her, but during the summer, no, we may not kindle it, since it is not a critical need for her during the summer. Veloi hi, but this is not so. Both these assumptions are incorrect. Lo yishna chayv, lo yishna chole. There's no difference between a woman who has given birth or a sick person. It doesn't make a difference if it's summer or winter. If one let blood and became chilled, we make for him a large fire, even at this time of year. Tammuz.
Yeah.
Summer solstice.
Yeah,
when the weather is hot. Shmuel salchu leitachtiko deshago. On one occasion, Shmuel let blood, and on his instructions, they chopped up for him a chair made of expensive shaga wood to fuel a fire to warm him, since no other firewood could be found. So it shows how badly he needed it.
Yeah.
Similarly, on one occasion, Rav Yehuda let blood, and they chopped up for him a table made from Yavne wood to fuel fire to warm him. For Rabbah, after he had let blood, they chopped up a footstool to fuel a fire. What is about Balta? Do not destroy. They did baltash. Amar leik baltash is the gufay difle. He said, "Do not destroy with respect to my body. Is more important for me. His body would be destroyed."
Yeah, there is a reason to do it. There's a difference between
just right. That's what he was saying. It's not baltashchis. I gotta protect my body.
They weren't destroying something.
So he destroyed the table, but yeah. It didn't. Shavua tov to everyone.
Shavua tov.
It says it's better for a person to sell the walls of his house and get himself shoes. Why? Why do you need to walk with shoes?
It's dangerous to walk without shoes.
Why is it dangerous to walk without shoes?
Step on something.
No, because of chilled.
Okay,
yeah, that's the issue. It's over here in 31, he writes, there's nothing more degrading than one who walks barefoot in public. One should rather be without a roof over his head than without shoes.
I'm 100% with that one.
Nevertheless, if one let blood and has nothing to eat afterwards, he should sell even the shoes that are on his feet and provide himself from the money he receives to have something to eat, for it is essential that one obtain the proper nourishment after bloodletting.
I'll buy that.
What are the requirements of a meal that are essential after bloodletting? Rav Amar Boso, Shmuel Amar Yain. Rav said after bloodletting you should eat meat, and Shmuel said you should drink wine. But told you to go into wine. Rav Amar Boso, Nafsho Chalav Nafsho. Rav say that meat is essential because he reasons that one must ingest life, meat, in place of life, the blood that was drained from him. Shmuel Amar Yain Sumka Chalav Sumka. Shmuel says that red wine is essential because one must ingest red wine in place of red blood. A menamenik sima shenimsa Shmuel b'yema David Milsa. One day Shmuel underwent the procedure of bloodletting. Ovadei Avshila Tochle. They made for him a cooked dish made of spleen. Rabbi Yochanan Shosi ad enofik tiyo meune. Rabbi Yochanan would drink wine until the scent came out of his ears. Rav Nachman Shosi ad kofe tchole. Rav Nachman would drink wine after bloodletting until his spleen floated in wine. Rav Yosef Shosi ad enofik mirido dechusliso. Rav Yosef would drink wine after bloodletting until it oozed from the puncture in the vein made by the blood letter lancet. Rabba Ma'adir HaChamu Ba'adloso Tarpei. Rabba would seek wine of three-leaf vine. Okay, what's a three-leaf vine? It says in 35, that is a vine that had produced three sets of leaves since taking root. In other words, a vine that was 3 years old. Amar lu Rav Nachman Yitzchak l'Rabbon v'mtusa minaychu, I beg of you, on the day of your undergoing bloodletting, imul v'itachu Nachman ikra l'Rabbon, tell your wives, Rav Nachman will be visiting us, and therefore they'll make a big meal,
yeah.
Make believe that I was your guest, and then they will make lots of food. Large meal.
Yeah.
So trick them. Tell them that we're having an important guest. They'll make a big meal. All deception is forbidden. Bama, accept this deception. Omu the Shori, accept this one. Why? Mando vid milso, accept this one. Now, Veloyev Sholo, one who undergoes the procedure of bloodletting and it is not possible for him to buy wine, for lack of funds, Lishko Zuz Amechor should take a worn out Zuz, which is no longer accepted as currency, Velezer Lishav Chanuso, and he should go to 7 wine shops and sample the wine. Ad the time Shu Revis, until he has sipped the volume of Revis wine. Veloy Lechul Shav Tam Ugmuso, he should eat 7 black dates, Velishof Mishcha Vitzidei, and rub oil into his temples, v'nigne v'shimsha, and sleep in the sun, and that would be instead of drinking wine. Avlet ashkech l'shmuel degone v'shimsha. Avlet, it was the name of a person, found Shmuel sleeping in the sun. He said to Shmuel, wise man of the Jews, can exposure to the sun, which is unhealthy, have beneficial effects? Amalei Shmuel said, it is the day of bloodletting, therefore sleeping in the sun is beneficial. But it was not so. Shmuel had not undergone bloodletting that day. Rather, there is one day in the entire year that exposure to the sun is beneficial. The day on which the Tammuz summer solstice falls, v'sova lo yigale, ben Shmuel reasoned, I shall not reveal this to him. It's not worthy to know about the summer solstice, and that's why he just told him that I did bloodletting today. Deception. Heikel b'ruachem shel simon is lenient with the wind. The taste waited It's a menominic we're going to discuss these words. Heikil b'ruach taima and shosim. Now, Rav Shmuel domit arvah, kol ha-meikil b'sudas ha-kozas dam. If someone is lax about the meal, following bloodletting, mekilom ezoisim neshomayim, then from the heavenly court, they are lax about supplying his provisions, his sustenance. For they say, if he does not show concern for his own life, shall I show concern for him? Why, man, David Milso, one wonder the procedure of bloodletting, should not sit where the wind swirls. For we are concerned that the bloodletter might have overly drained him of blood. And reduced it to the bare minimum of one revis necessary to sustain life. And the wind might come and draw from him just a bit more blood. It will come to a life-threatening situation. Shmuel. Shmuel was accustomed to undergo the procedure of bloodletting in a house made of walls that were 7.5 bricks thick, so that they would be well insulated from the chilling effects of the wind. One day he underwent bloodletting in that house, as usual, and felt a certain weakness in himself. So he examined the walls of the house and he found one half brick on the wall's usual thickness missing. So one who undergoes the procedure of bloodletting should eat something first and then leave the house. For if he does not eat anything before leaving, he exposes himself to a host of dangers. If he meets up with a corpse, his face will turn green. If he meets up with a murderer, he will die. If he meets up with other things, with a swine, it is harmful with regard to that other thing, which is tzaras, leprosy. Rabbi Shmuel Damit Tavai Mind David Mills. One undergoes the procedure of bloodletting. Lishi put of other lekum should wait a little only, then get up to go. Domar Mar Chamish Advar Kolim Yisus Minachayim. Five things bring a person closer to death than to life. Ve'eluhen, and these are Ochal Ve'omad. If one eats and stands up immediately, dangerous. Shosa v'omad, if one drinks and stands up immediately. Yosha v'omad, if one sleeps and stands up immediately. Kizdan v'omad, if one undergoes bloodletting and stands up immediately. Shimish mitosi v'omad, if one engages in conjugal relations and stands up immediately. Amash mo pulsa de domo kot lo sinyomim, the time for letting blood is every 30 days. When a poking might, and when one reaches the point between the first two stages of life. What is the first two stages of life? After reaching the age of 40, he should decrease the frequency of bloodletting. When upon reaching the point between the next two stages of life, he should begin decrease the frequency of bloodletting. It says in number 6, after reaching the age of 60. The appropriate time for one to let blood is either on a Sunday, Wednesday, or Friday, but not on Monday and Thursday. Rav said, only a person that has one who has ancestral merit to protect him can take the risk and let his blood on a Monday and Thursday, or Thursday. And why is it dangerous to let blood on Monday and Thursday? Because the heavenly court and the lower earthly, the lower court, the earthly one, are in session at the same time. And what is the reason that one should, we said Monday, was, we said the best time to do it is Sunday, Wednesday, or Friday. So what's wrong? We said Monday and Monday and Thursday is the heavenly court, right, and the lower court. But what about Tuesday? It says because on Tuesday the influence of Mars prevails during the pairs, the even hours of the day. But on Friday the influence of Mars also prevails during the even hours of the day. And still Shmuel listed as of one of the allowable times for bloodletting. Even the Dorshu B'Rabim, since many have trampled a beaten path upon it. Since it has become common practice to let blood on Friday, we may say that Shoyim Psein Avaye, Hashem protects the heedless. It says in 12, that is, though a particular behavior should be considered dangerous, the fact that it has become common practice causes God to protect his heedless children from the harmful effects of their imprudent actions. We apply this principle only in cases where we see that the overwhelming majority of people are in fact not harmed by such behavior, but where we find that a significant number of people do suffer harm from it. Since it is evident that God is not protecting the heedless, in this case, it is forbidden. So the best time to do it would be Sunday and Wednesday. Amar Shmuel Dalad the Huar Bo, letting blood on the fourth day of the week, Wednesday, that is also the fourth day of the month. Dalad the Huar Besa, or letting blood on the fourth day of the week, that is also the 14th day of the month. Dalad dehu esrim arbo, or letting blood on the fourth day of the week, that is also the 24th day of the month. Dalad deleko arbo basrei, or letting blood on the first day of the week, where there are not 4 days after it in the month. The Gemara says sakanto is dangerous. Letting blood on the first of the month or the next day causes weakness. Shlishi loy sakono. Letting blood on the third day of the month is actually dangerous. Letting blood on the eve, the day before Yom Tov, causes weakness. But on the eve of Shavuos, it is actually dangerous. Therefore, the rabbis decreed that one should not let blood on the eve of any Yom Tov. Because of the concern that one might come to do so on the eve of the Yom Tov of Shavuos, when there is actual danger. For on it, the day before Shavuos, a wind blows, whose name is Tavoyach, slaughtering the Ilokabul Yisrael Torah, or had Israel not accepted the Torah, but Torah Yisrael Domayo, this wind would have slaughtered them, their flesh and their blood. Omar Shmuel, Locha Chitovik is dam. If one ate wheat and then let his blood, Loikizel Osachito, he has let blood only for the sake of that wheat. But this statement regarding the uselessness of letting blood after eating applies only when one wishes to let blood for general therapeutic purposes. But if one is letting blood to lighten the burden of excess blood in his body, he may lighten it even after eating and accomplish his purpose. If one lets his blood, drinking should follow immediately. Achila ad chatzimil. Eating should wait until the time it takes to walk half a mil elapses. Ibalu shtil alta male. Does it mean that drinking immediately after letting blood is beneficial? Aval bosa ochi koshe. But drinking after immediately is detrimental. Or perhaps it means that drinking sometimes later is neither beneficial nor detrimental. The Gemara says teiku. If 100 gourds go for a zuz,
you missed after teiku. About walking. You see?
No.
Okay, you said teiku. Right under teiku is iba ya luhu.
No, it says Rav offers advice on other health related matters. No, that speaks about no, I don't have it.
Oh, wow.
I'm going to read it from here.
Okay.
Achila ad chatzi mil, ude kamale, ibalo. So they inquired, does it mean that eating at an interval of exactly the time it takes to walk half a meal is beneficial, or bosa hochi umakame hochi koshi, but eating after this time or before this time is detrimental, or perhaps it means only that eating before or after this time is neither detrimental or no beneficial. So the Gemara concludes, stay cool, let this matter be unresolved. And with that, go to Machiz Rav.
That's weird.
So it's the same question about eating that we said before about drinking.
Is it Machiz Rav Ma'ei Kori?
Me'er Kori Bezuzah. If 100 gourds go for a zuz, one should buy them. Me'er Roshi Bezuzah. If 100 animal heads go for a zuz, one should buy them. Me'er Shfome V'lo Ichlum. But even if 100 animal
lips
cost nothing, one should not bother taking them, for they serve no benefit. Okay, the lips of the animal.
Yeah.
Amar Yosef, upon hearing this advice of Rav, Rav Yosef remarked, "Ki avinan beiravun ayom de mepagre beiravun." When we were in Rav Huna's academy, on the day that the rabbis, the disciples, were lazy about coming to the study hall, people would say, today is a lip day. And I did not understand what they were saying. Now, however, that I have heard this teaching of Rav, that the worthlessness of animal lips, I realize that they meant to say, today is a worthless day which accomplished nothing. The Koshna Tabu, when we tie the umbilical cord of a newborn on the Shabbos. Abyesi says, we also sever it. Anu Rabon Koshna Tabu, we tie the umbilical cord of a newborn on the Shabbos. Abyesi says, we also sever it. Toyma Shugashiacham Avlo, then we may envelop the placenta so that the newborn will be warm. I'm Rabbi Shimon Gamliel said, "Benois Melochim, time to just follow Hashem." The daughters of royalty envelop the placenta in balls of oil. Benois Hashirim Besvegim Shod Samer. The daughters of the wealthy envelop it in wads of combed wool. Benois Anim Bemuchim. The daughters of the poor envelop it in soft rags. The Gemara rules on the dispute between the Tanakhama and Rabbi Yosi, Amar Rav Nachman, Amar Rav Baravua, Amar Rav, Alocha ki Rabbi Yosi, Alocha follows Rabbi Yosi, who states that we do cut the umbilical cord on the Shabbos. Amar Rav Nachman, Amar Rav Baravua, Amar Rav, Moedim Chachom Rabbi Yosi, B'tavu Shoshone Dinoke Shechoschim. The sages, Tanakhama, concede to Rabbi Yosi in the case of the umbilical cord of newborn twins, that we cut it on the Shabbos. My time, what is the reason that the sages concede in this case? The menatrea dode, because the twin newborns would tend to pull away from one another, which would dislodge the cord and place them in danger. Whatever is mentioned in the passage of remonstration, passage of rebuke, we may do for a woman who has given birth, for a newborn child on the Shabbos. For it states in the passage of remonstration, and in regard to your birth, on the day of your birth, your umbilical cord has not cut, nor were you washed with water to smooth the skin, nor were you salted at all, nor were you swaddled at all. The Gemara expounds the various elements mentioned in the pasuk, and in regard to your birth, on the day of your birth, from here we see that we deliver a child on the Shabbos. That your umbilical cord was not cut. From here we see that we cut the umbilical cord on the Shabbos. No, were you washed with water to smooth the skin. From here we see that we washed a newborn on Shabbos. No. Were you salted at all? From here we see that we salt a newborn on the Shabbos. We apply salt to his skin in order to harden it. Alternatively, salting refers not to the application of actual salt, but rather to a powder made of ground myrtle and the like. Ve'huchtel lochutolt mikan shem lapefin avlod b'Shabbos. No, were you swaddled at all? From here we see that we swaddle the newborn on the Shabbos in order to force the bones and joints that were bent or dislodged during delivery back into place. This is not the same procedure as Asuvi Yenuka, straightening the infant, which of Nachman himself abids above, because it is skin, it's akin to repairing. Therefore, the reference is to straightening the bones by hand, whereas here the infant is simply swaddled. Adron Aloch Mefanim will return to you, Mefanim.
That was interesting.
God willing, we'll continue tomorrow, chapter 19.
And now we get into the meal. But I would have thought that the Gemara would have done the